In a similar way to the previous example, we can find out the force between two infinite parallel lines carrying current I. So, assuming that we have two infinite parallel lines, and these two parallel lines carrying current I, one, assuming that in positive x direction and the other in negative x direction, so the magnetic force from one to the other can be obtained as we can find out the magnetic field from the first one, so on the second one, so the magnetic field in this case would be I over 2 by D. Then this magnetic flux density based on Ampere's law would be in the negative x direction, and here we have the current in negative x direction. So in this case, IdL cross B would introduce the force in this direction, or in other words, we can assume that this is the source of the magnetic field. So the magnetic field from this current on this wire would be in negative z direction. So IdL cross B, IdL cross B would introduce a force in this direction. If we are assuming that we are interested in the force per unit length, so it would be the magnitude of the magnetic flux density, which is mu naught I over 2 by D, multiplied by the current, and instead of the length, we are going to use web. So in this case, it would be mu naught I over 2 by D, multiplied by I by 1, such that this one, or the final one, is unit length along L. So the force between two infinite lines carrying a current I and parallel to each other equals mu naught I over 2 by the separation distance between them, and the force is in Newton. If the two currents are in opposite direction, then the force would be repelling. If the two currents are in the same direction, it would be attraction. And effectively, this very simple rule for the force between two parallel wires carrying current I, they are used to introduce a new definition for the current units ampere. The current units ampere, or assuming that I have 1 ampere in this line and 1 ampere in this line, and the separation between them are 1 meter, so the force in this case, mu naught, would be mu naught multiplied by 1 multiplied by 1 over 2 by over 1 meter. So in this case, the force would be 4 by multiplied by 10 to the power minus 7 over 2 by. So it actually equals 2 multiplied by 10 to the power minus 7 newton. So we can introduce a new definition for the unit current ampere as the current which, if it passes through two parallel lines, the force between them and these two parallel lines are separated by a unit distance, 1 meter. So the force between these two lines would be 0.2 micronewton. So the current which introduces the force 0.2 micronewton between two lines separated by 1 meter, this carat is 1 ampere. Okay. Now, what will be the situation if we are talking about differential current elements? So, assuming that we have two differential current elements, I1DL1 and I2DL2, and the distance between them is R12, what will be the magnetic force from 1 to 2 and from 2 to 1? So, assuming that we are going to discuss the magnetic force on 1 due to the magnetic field introduced by the element 2. So the magnetic field introduced by element 2 at the point 1 can be obtained by using Bayes-Savart law as dH2 would equal I'm interested in finding out the force of the point 2 due to the current 1. So, dH2 here is the current at the point 2 due to the current element 1. And is by using Bayes-Savart law, the magnetic field at point 2, dH2, equals I1 dL1 cross the unit vector to the observation point AR12 over 4 by R12 squared. This is the magnetic field at the point 2 due to the incremental current I1DL1. Now, the force on the incremental current I2DL2 would equal IDL cross B. So I here, it would be I2DL2 cross the magnetic field at the point 2, which is introduced from the current element 1. And the magnetic flux density B2 can be obtained from the magnetic field by multiplying by mu naught. So dB2 would equal mu naught dH2. So, in this case, we can find out the incremental force on the element current 2 due to the magnetic field induced by the element current 1, which will be named as DDF2, incremental, DDF2, the force on the elemental current 2 would equal mu naught multiplied by I1 multiplied by DL1 cross AR12 over 4 by R12 squared. This combined with this corresponds to B2, dB2. This would be multiplied by I2 dL2 cross product with this one. Okay? So, first of all, we make this cross product, dL1 cross AR12, and after obtaining this cross product, we obtain the cross product DL2 with this cross product to obtain the direction and the value of DL2, DL1, AR12, and multiply it by the scalar quantity mu naught I1, I2 over 4 by R12 squared. So, this is the force at element 2 due to the current or due to the magnetic field induced by the current element 1. As an example, assume that the point one is located at x equals 3 and y equal 1. I1 dl1 is assumed to be minus 3 in y direction, is negative y direction, ampere meter, and located at the point 5 of the x, 2 y, and 1 of z. And I2 dl2, let us assume it, minus 4 in z direction, so it is negative z direction. Ampere meter at the point x equal 1, y x equal 1, y equals 8, and z equal 5. So R12, the direction from 1 to 2, can be obtained as the value of x of 2 minus the value of x of 1 in x direction, minus 4 ax, the value of x in 2, the value of y in 2, minus the value of y in 1, in y direction, so it is 6 ay, the value of z of 2, minus the value of z in 1, in z direction, so it is 4 az. So this is r12. To obtain the unit vector, we divide r12 by its absolute value. The absolute value is the square root of 4 squared plus 6 squared plus 4 squared. So by dividing this by the absolute value, we can obtain the unit vector AR12. Okay. Now let us take all these pieces together to obtain the force at the point 2 due to the current 1. So in this case, ddf2 would be mu naught 4 by 2 multiplied by 10 to the power minus 7 over 4 by over r12 squared. R12 squared is 4 squared plus 6 squared plus 4 squared. 4 squared 16, 6 squared 36, 4 squared 16. And because we need another one in the unit vector, ar12, so this would be to the power 3 over 2. Okay? Now, I1 as a magnitude, and vector I1, I2, dl2. So let us start with I2, dl2. I2, dl2 is minus 4, is it? Cross I1, dl1. I1 dl1 is minus 3 ay. Di1 dl1 is cross the unit vector of ar12. So it is r12 over the square root of the amplitude. So, or the magnitude of r12. So this r12 and the magnitude in the denominator already. Now, we take this cross product, minus 3 ay, ay cross ax is minus z, so it is minus 12 in az, ay cross ay is 0, ay cross az, it would be x direction, ay cross az in x direction, so it is minus 12 in x direction, so it is ay. Ay cross ax negative z, so it is negative 12 in z direction and negative 12 in x direction. Now negative 12 in z direction, negative 12 in x direction would be cross product with az, so the z component, which introduced from ay cross ax, would be eliminated. and the x component, we have minus 12 in x direction. So minus 12 multiplied by minus 4 will be 48. AZ cross AX, it would be in y direction. So this would be 48 in y direction. So it is in y direction, and 48 over this value. So it can be obtained as 8.56 in y direction nanometer. Alright. Now if you are interested in finding out the force on the incremental lens, when due to the magnetic field from 2, we are going to make the same steps but in reverse. So, it is interesting to find out the result of the force in the element 1 in this case. It is not equal to the magnitude of the force in the element 2. And it is not in the opposite direction. This is direction Y and this is direction Z. So, this is not like the case of the force between point of charge. In the case of the force between point of charge, the force from 1 to 2 equal in magnitude the force from 2 to 1 and in opposite direction. But here the situation is different. Why? That's what we are seeing. The electric force exerted by one point of charge on another point of charge, we found that the force in the first charge was the negative of that of the second. That is, the total force in the system is zero. The reason for this behavior lies because non-physical nature of the current element. In the case of the current element, we cannot find a small infinitesimal current element. Effectively, the current is coming from a complete circuit. So, in the case of electric point of charge, we can find a point of charge, but we cannot find incremental current element. So, from the continuity of the current, it is required to complete circuit, or in other words, we should make this current on a complete circuit or a complete closed loop, not infinitesimal current element. So, effectively, the force between infinitesimal current element is just a hypothetical problem, not a real physical problem. That's why the force between the two current elements is not equal. Now, instead of talking about infinitesimal current element, we can talk about the force between two circuits. In the case of two circuits, we say that the force in two due to one, it was ddF2, and it was found as mu naught I1 I2 over 4 by R12 square dL2 cross dL1 cross AR12. The total force on the circuit 2, it can be obtained by integrating the current on the closed circuit L2 and on the closed circuit L1. And effectively, if we take this force F2 and we obtain the force F1 due to the circuit 2, it would be just the reverse of this element and it would be equal the same value and opposite direction in this case. So if I'm talking about a complete circuit, the force from circuit 1 to circuit 2 equal and opposite in direction to the force on circuit 2 from circuit 1. But if I'm talking about incremental current element, it is not equal. Effectively, this form can be simplified as mu naught I1 I2 over 4 by the integration over the closed bus, the integration over the closed bus AR12 cross DL1 cross DL2 over R12 square. And this can be obtained by interchanging the elements of the cross product. Okay? So this is the total force between two closed circuits due to the magnetic field from one to the other. Alright.